Good evening. The opinions and statements voiced by our guests do not necessarily reflect the opinions of this network. Enjoy the shows.
You are listening to WBHM, Digital Broadcasting, the best in paranormal talk only on Paranormal Experience Radio. Broadcasting live out of Birmingham, Alabama.
Welcome to the Paranormal Experienced Radio Show with your host, Captain Hobson. We are here to learn all we can about every type of experience within the paranormal. There will be interviews with seasoned investigators of the spiritual realm, including ufologists, cryptozoologists, psychics, mediums, authors, and creators of technology, and others with credible knowledge to share. Together, we will find out what brought these investigators of the unknown into the field and learn what keeps them working so hard in it. I'm interested in learning how these individuals go about their work, and I believe you are too. This program is all about bringing those who are in the field together with our listeners who are interested in what they find. For us, the paranormal is all about working with and supporting each other. We're all here seeking answers to the questions that bother us so. Now, let's get those answers and enjoy the show.
Good evening. Welcome to WBHM Digital Broadcasting out of Birmingham, Alabama. You are listening to Paranormal Experienced. I am Kat Hobson, your host, and I am so glad that you're here. I am absolutely thrilled to be hosting this show with Ronnie. I know that most of y'all know that Ronnie Dee is the owner of Old South Pittsburg Hospital, but he is also an absolutely wonderful investigator in his own right. He has been featured on Destination Fear, the episode at his facility. He's probably been on all kinds of other things too that I just simply don't know right now. But I do know that he is a gracious host. He is a great coordinator. He is somebody that I admire a lot and I enjoy being around. So, you know, with that being said, let's bring him on, right? Hello there,
good
Ronnie.
Evening, Hobson. How are you?
So formal. You're never formal with me.
That's true.
That was good, though.
I'm sorry.
Well,
thank you so much for having me on tonight.
Well, thank you for being had. I've got to tell you, I love talking with you. Not only for your professionalism,
one of my favorite shows to be on. This is one of my favorite shows to be on. I have the utmost respect for you and what you do in the paranormal. And like I said, you and I talked the other day, and anybody who listens to you knows that you have got one of the most wonderful voices in talk radio. You know, before the show, we were talking about you doing voiceovers. We've got to figure out how to do it because you would be just an incredible spokesperson for those beautiful beaches in Alabama that you've been visiting lately.
Well, I will tell you that means a lot to me because I love these beaches with all my heart. This is my place to come when I need healing. This is my place to come when I'm just thrilled to pieces. This is my place, period. And one of my favorite musicians and songwriters wrote a song called I Have Found Me a Home. And this is it. And it's really funny because I was in the Lowe's here earlier this week. I'm down here doing projects that I know nothing about, but I'm doing them. And that song played on their music at Lowe's. And I was like, oh, yes, I have. This is my happy place.
I know that feeling. I mean, I know that feeling. I feel that way. We don't have a beach in front of the hospital, unfortunately, but I know that there's, like, you know, all of us as human beings, we all have that one location or that one place in life where we either call it home or we call it our comfort spot or mm-hmm. just that location that we can sit back and we can just, you know, the world problems go away. We forget about COVID. We forget about everything that's going on in the world. And, you know, OSPH is one of those places for me. So I can definitely relate to that beachfront property that you're enjoying. You know, OSPH does that for me. And like I said, it's just when you open up those front doors and you walk inside and you're just in a whole different world. And so, yeah, so I respect that. And I totally get it and understand where you're coming from with that beautiful beach.
Well, you know, it's really good. When I was down here last weekend, I could have flown my grandson if I'd held his hand and opened his coat, right? Because it was that windy. And it was just, you know, we went to Fort Morgan, which is one of my favorite haunted places as well. And I wouldn't even let him go up on the top because I was getting blown around in the tunnels. So there was no way that we were going high, and we went out.
It's been a crazy, crazy couple of weeks with weather. I mean, you know, Tennessee, we're, you know, 17, 18 degrees and we get a ton of snow. And I think today it was almost 70 degrees. So yeah, just the weather swings have been crazy, but spring looks like it's on its way. And I couldn't be more excited about what's coming up, you know, in the next couple of months with warmer weather and t-shirts and shorts and paranormal investigating and guests and cleaning and fixing and painting. So we have a lot to look forward to this spring.
Well, I agree. And, you know, it's really odd to me because, you know, when you mention COVID, there are so many people that have disregarded it or whatever. And I have friends, and it's really odd. I have not lost friends in the early stages, except for Richard Rose. But I have recently lost friends, which it just seems crazy. You know, maybe it's morphing again, and it's not going after the older people now. It's shifting again or something. That is the most bizarre virus I've ever heard of.
It really is. And I've got to admit to everybody, I've actually been down for a couple of weeks. I'm just actually coming out of quarantine.
Yeah.
Cause I got it too. And you know, I tried my hardest not to get it, you know, masked up, washed, sanitized. I did everything in my power to make sure that I didn't contract the virus. I got the virus, and with me, you know, I mean, I was lucky. I had 2 days of fever, 2 days of, you know, achy bones, and, you know, the next 12 days, I was bored out of my mind because, you know, I'm back to being me again. And it is a very unique virus because it seems to really attack people in very different ways. And,
yes,
you know, we've lost a lot of people, you know, in this country to the virus, and it's a very sad situation. And I'm just fortunate that, you know, I did contract it. I did come down with it. But apparently I must have a pretty strong immune system or whatever, because it didn't take me very long to get over it. And so, you know, just coming out of quarantine, looking forward to actually getting some sun on my bones and being
yes.
able to get back out into the field and that kind of stuff. But yeah, I haven't personally lost anybody to COVID. I know that, you know, I have friends of friends who have lost people to COVID.
Yes.
And it's a shame. And hopefully, you know, between the vaccine and between, you know, I mean, it going away, hopefully we're going to get to live a normal life coming up pretty soon here. And like I said, my heart does go out to everybody who's had somebody who's either been infected and had some serious complications, or, you know, unfortunately have lost a life. And it's a bad situation. Hopefully, as a country, we're turning a corner, and you know, we can look forward to the future.
Well, I am counting on it, because I do not want to live indoors for much longer. It's just one of those things that humans don't deal well in captivity. So it's just one of those things that, you know, we are supposed to be free,
you know,
and roaming.
I have to tell you, we were just talking about this. I have some friends that I've been in close contact with. And, you know, the single probably most important thing that I'm missing out of life not being normal is concerts.
Yes.
I mean,
oh, my
music
gosh.
Is such a way that, you know, it just, music is a way of expression of feeling. And, you know, when you're having a really lousy day, you can put a song on the radio and it makes you feel so much better.
Absolutely.
In my opinion, there's, you know, next to paranormal investigating, one of my favorite things is going to see a good concert and, you know, being with friends. And to me, that's probably the single most aspect of life that I'm missing the most out of is going to see concerts. And, you know, whether you're a classical fan or a heavy metal fan, I mean, it's just a really sad situation not to be able to spend, you know, a lot of time, a couple hours with 35,000 of your best friends enjoying, you know, some of the greatest music in the world. So that's what I'm looking forward to. I'm hoping that we can get back to kind of life and go see some concerts and, you know, and do those kind of things again.
Well, I am so ready. You know, I have been really enjoying getting to know different music, because I have become tired of listening to my same old playlist. And I've gone back through and, you know, I'm doing evidence reviews and all the things. And, you know, it's just, I am just ready.
Come on, Cam, tell the truth. You've been reconnecting with the oldies. You're that old Elvis Presley on, listening to a little Otis Redding. Got some of the old.
Oh, no, Otis Redding, right? I do like Otis Redding. But, you know, I work at the Hangout Fest, or have worked at the Hangout Fest down here for a few years, and I love music festivals. Who knew, right? And so they have such an amazing, eclectic programming. You know, it's just really cool. And everything from, you know, the Foo Fighters to Michael Franti to, what's her name in the Machine? Florence in the Machine. I mean, there's just been people, unbelievable bands that they bring in here. So it's just fun.
And how far are you from OSPH? Because once those festivals start up, I think you're going to have to invite myself and some of our volunteers to come down and enjoy a couple of those festivals.
Well, Old South Pittsburg is 2 miles from me. And from door to door, this is 426 miles.
Oh, so about 6.5 hours?
Roughly, yeah. So
we can do that, right, Daniel? Right, Daniel? I know Daniel Dorsey's listening out there.
Daniel
we
is
got
listening.
That big old diesel truck. Yeah, we can load up all the volunteers, get in the back, put a keg of beer back there. Just kidding.
Well, you know, as long as your driver is not drinking, sure. So, but, you know, you mentioned your volunteers. You have got brilliant volunteers there. I don't know.
You know, we do need to take a second and kind of shout out. I do have 40 volunteers on my team, and most of them are probably, hopefully, listening. Hi, everybody. I know everybody's been real concerned about me because I did get the COVID virus. And I will tell you, I've never been part of something more special than what we have going on at OSPH. We have some new members who were brought on board, the Stevens, the Terrys, the Heathers. If anybody I'm missing, I'm sorry, I apologize. And then we've got the old timers like Daniel, Darla, Brooke, and Leanne, and Heath, and Ashley, and Sean. But I will tell you that there isn't a better group of individuals that I have met in my entire life than this group of 40 people that are involved in OSPH. These people give me so much time, so much energy. They work so hard, unconditionally, sometimes to the point where we all look at each other and we're just exhausted. You know, I couldn't ask for a better group of individuals. And, you know, there's a lot of that love word going around. There's a lot of family, you know, a lot of people really use those words. And I don't think they really know the true meaning of those words. I will tell you, for the first time in my life, I can honestly say that the family and the love that goes on at OSPH is second to none. These people are just absolutely amazing. And like I said, you know, OSPH is a conglomeration of many different ideas and people. And I would be nothing without these people. It's just amazing. It's amazing the amount of work that they put in. It's also the amazing amount of fun that we have. We do have a lot of fun, but I am nothing without these people. And to each and every one of you who are listening, I get a little emotional, but I love each and every one of you. And like I said, it's just amazing that I can call them friends, and that, and more importantly, they're my family. I mean, they really are. These are people, like I said, who check on me daily, who made phone calls, who sent me text messages, who, you know, made sure I was okay during my time of need. And you just can't ask for a better family than that. And I appreciate that.
Well, you know what?
So,
they love you. They love you. And, you know, I'm going to tell you.
Somebody has to.
I do not believe that that's a problem for you. You are brilliant, and you're kind, and you're wonderful.
Not with this group of people.
No. So I did not realize that so many people travel so far to get there. And, because I was talking about how far I am.
2 hours.
Yeah. And it is pretty astounding to see the difference that your volunteers have wrought, and you, in the facility. I was going through some of the pictures that I have that I use when we're doing, you know, a show together, and I had forgotten that there's one there from my very first trip up there, and it is on the wall. Was on the wall. It's not now. So I was like, wow, I wonder if he knows that that's my name on that. And it was, you know, I love there. I have never been disappointed. I've always gotten evidence. I've never been harmed. And I think that I'm very fortunate to be able to have had so much time alone there, because the previous manager was late getting there one time, and I was by myself for about an hour and a half. I thought there was a volunteer there, but they were in another room, and I was just wandering everywhere saying, hello, hello. They never heard me. So I got to do a solo investigation there with equipment for about an hour and a half. And then when I came up for my first actually walking on my own event at your place, yeah, you trusted me enough to leave me there for a while. There is just something about being alone in Old South Pittsburgh Hospital. It's a gift, but we have to take a break. We are already at our first break. I can't believe it.
Oh my gosh.
I know, right? Time flies when we get together. So we will be right back. Y'all come right back too.
You are listening to WBHM Digital Broadcasting, Birmingham, Alabama.
Oh, come on. I'm Southern, but... nope. That'll do. Hello, I am Kat Hobson, host of Paranormal Experience here on WBHM Digital Broadcasting out of Birmingham, Alabama. I enjoy having guests from all areas of the paranormal, from ghosts to ufology to cryptids and beyond. You'll find some of the best researchers in their fields bringing you some great information. Join me on Wednesday nights from 8 to 10 p.m. Eastern here on WBHM Digital Broadcasting.
You are listening to WBHM, Digital Broadcasting, the best in paranormal talk only on Paranormal Experience Radio. Broadcasting live out of Birmingham, Alabama. Since 1948, Fate Magazine has brought you reports of the strange and unknown, all of them true. Fate Radio is carrying on that tradition, bringing you the unusual, macabre, strange, and bizarre. Join host Kat Hobson Sunday nights from 8 to 10 p.m. Eastern on WBHM Digital Broadcasting. You are listening to WBHM Digital Broadcasting. The best in paranormal talk, only on Paranormal Experience Radio, broadcasting live out of Birmingham, Alabama.
This is Jason Bland, host of Midwest Paranormal Presents Paranormal Soup, where we stream live as a webcast every Sunday night, 11 p.m. to 2 a.m. Eastern, with guests who will blow your mind. Live ghost box sessions where you can call into the show to see if the spirits will talk to you, and the World Wide Web of Weird with the latest in paranormal news and evidence. We're bringing the weird every Sunday night, 11 p.m. to 2 a.m. Eastern, on our Facebook page and YouTube channel. Don't forget to follow and subscribe.
Thank you for listening to WBHM Digital Broadcasting out of Birmingham, Alabama. The time is 23 minutes after the hour.
Welcome back to Paranormal Experience here on WBHM Digital Broadcasting. I am so glad you're here because this is going to be so much fun. I have been talking, well, it's already so much fun. I have been talking with my friend Ronnie Dee, who owns the Old South Pittsburg Hospital Paranormal Research Center, and we have just blown through that first 20 minutes, and Ronnie, I am so enjoying our contact. It's just awesome.
Oh, me too.
So,
20 minutes went flying by, didn't it?
It did, and it always does when we get together, though. I mean, truly. But, you know, I stay out of the loop most of the time. I did not know that you were on Destination Fear. And I don't know why I didn't know that.
Yeah.
It's been a while. And so...
Yeah, I think... go ahead. I'm sorry.
No, I mean, I don't know why I didn't get that memo. So...
No, that's okay. It was actually myself, Renee, Daniel, and Darla, I believe. All four of us were on Destination Fear, which was a great show. Really enjoyed that show. But we were on Kindred Spirits. We had Amy and Adam and Chip out. And that was my favorite show. We had some time... I know me, Daniel, Darla, and a bunch of the volunteers all had some time with Adam and Amy in the trailer on the side of the building. And I will tell you what, in the paranormal world, those are two of the most amazing people I have ever had the opportunity to meet. I know Daniel and Darla will tell you the same thing. Adam is probably one of the funniest paranormal personalities I think I've ever met in my entire life.
Adam is wicked funny. Halls. Yeah.
Oh gosh, she's skipping down the halls, singing "Zippy Doo Da Day," and we had so much fun. We did, and to be with some of these guys and the Destination Fear guys and the production staff was just amazing. I know Daniel and I got to do some of our own shooting, which was kind of cool. We got to operate some of the cameras and some of the systems.
Oh,
and
how
some
fun.
Of the footage. And it was a lot of fun. I mean, the Destination Fear guys, their camera crew was, you know, they're second to none. Daniel and I had, you know, a field day. The guy throws a $100,000 camera on my shoulder and says, "Film something." And I'm like, I'm shaking, and you know, you didn't expect that. And I know, right. Daniel was really excited because Daniel got to take some footage of the third floor. He got to use some of the really expensive, you know, equipment. And it's really, really neat because I don't think that people outside of watching it on TV realize how many hours of filming that
right.
they go through, you know, to
True.
Come up with just an hour's worth of a show. And it was really unique because I have never seen it before. I've never really been behind the scenes of a show like that before. And to watch these guys and to watch how they position cameras and they do, you know, certain things to make it real appeasing and kind of scary on TV was just, it was really neat. It was a real eye opener. And I think that's something that like was just really, really fortunate that a lot of us got to be involved in. And and the Destination Fears guys, they were just so professional, so kind. And like I said, it was really kind of neat to be able to interact with them and to see how they do what they do and how they put a show together.
Well, I know that I was on a different show, and that was something that wowed me too, though, because I don't know what I expected, but the production crew, I did not know that the director had won 2 Emmys. But
oh, wow.
Yeah. And so it was interesting to watch because she was gracious and kind, not the least bit, you know, overly assertive with anyone that I saw at all. And, but it ran like clockwork. From the people that had the the runner jobs up to the executive producer. I mean, everything was so professional, so crisp, so clear. So we want you to do this. It was really neat, and I didn't expect that for some reason. I don't know what I thought would happen.
And I don't think they get enough credit because the overall creativity of them getting a shot down a hallway, mm-hmm. I don't have that in me. I just don't have that, like that skill set that, you know, they made OSPH look so different on film than it does,
yes.
In real life, and hitting those angles and, you know, doing the things that they do with their creative mind is just, like I said, I watched the show. I sat back and I'm like, is that really my building? Because you don't realize how incredibly artistic they are when they're
yes.
doing those shots and when they're doing some of the things that they do. You know, to me, I mean, God, I'm lucky enough to be able to press the trigger on a camera and get a shot of the front of the building. And these guys are making the front of the building look just massive.
Magnificent,
just,
too.
You know, yeah. And just, and like I said, I mean, there's definitely a creativity side of them that like I said, that Daniel and Darla and I got to realize that these guys are really, really have a really keen eye. And for them to, like you said, make a building look as magnificent as they did, it's just a lot of credit to, you know, to them and their abilities and to be able to do that and still have fun. And like
yes.
you said, and not be bossy and not be kind of condescending and, you know, to take the time with us and be like, you're doing it all wrong. This is the angle we're looking for. It was so neat. It was so cool. And then, yeah. You know, a lot of times they would play back that little excerpt of what they're filming. And like you said, and you know, they're just off like a centimeter. I mean, literally like the door frame is out of, you know, center by a centimeter. And so they adjust the camera and you're like, really? I would have never noticed that watching it on TV, but they're just so meticulous. And so, it was really cool. It was a lot of fun.
Yeah. But you know, yeah, that's why they're the people making the stuff that's on TV, right? Because they do notice that those things, they do have that attention to detail. And right. I had mentioned to a friend of mine who does movies and stuff that this is incredible. He's like, yeah, well, there's a lot of competition for their jobs. If they don't do it right, somebody will. And
it's so funny how it just comes very natural to them.
Yes, they're just fighting comfy.
Over it and trying to struggle, and it's just very natural. They look at it, and you know, even the guy who was flying the drone out front, you know, just watching him fly the drone.
Yes.
Yeah.
I love that.
Watching him fly the drone. Yeah, and getting the right shots and putting the drone in the exact place so that they don't get too much roof and they get a little bit of this and a little bit of that and you know, I mean, fighting the winds in South Pittsburgh in the middle, you know, when they were filming and just getting that perfect shot, and you're just standing back there kind of awe-inspired.
It is awe-inspiring. I did not know that, and I'm sure yours did too, but the drone guy on Portals to Hell has an FAA license to fly that because, you know, they do go pretty high and they do fancy stuff. And I had no idea that level of expertise was involved with a drone. So
yeah, it was
I'm sure your guy did too.
To do us.
Yeah.
Well, it was actually kind of funny when they came out to do us, because when they were actually doing our event, the drone broke on the poor guy.
Oh,
so
no.
He didn't crash it. He didn't do anything that was inappropriate or, you know, flying into a tree, but it just stopped working. And so, you know, you're seeing them panicking because, you know, obviously production, they're in a time frame. So they're, you know, calling Best Buy and all these other places to get another drone. And, you know, lo and behold, you see the guy go flying out of the building, cruises over to Best Buy, picks up another drone and starts it all over again. So, but they did have a couple of issues with the drone. And like I said, that would have been me panicking. And they're just all kind of like, yeah, we'll get this taken care of. And so it was kind of neat to actually watch them work with adversity even.
Yeah, and they know how professional they are. They know it's going to come together. So I was just knocked out. I'm glad that was such a positive experience for y'all, because y'all deserve that. Y'all do a great job. You've got a great facility. The activity is off the chain, and it's pretty cool. Now, I have a question for you.
It is.
Go ahead. It is what?
No, I was going to say it is. It's really kind of neat, because one of the things that I think is really special to us at OSPH is the historic value of the building.
Yes, exactly.
And now that we're on Destination Fear, now that we're on Kindred Spirits, we're on something bigger, and the hospital gets that, I guess, credit or whatever you want to say for what it deserves to be on TV.
Yes.
Now not only is it something that our little community of South Pittsburgh and Marion County knows about, but now it's a nationwide building.
Yes.
It's a building that's recognized. It's a building that's getting the credit that it deserves. So it's kind of a two-part thing that, yeah, we're on Destination Fear and Kindred Spirits, but what's really neat is that the building is getting its national playtime that it really, really deserves, because it was a really, really important building to Marion County and all the surrounding, you know, communities around it in terms of healthcare when it was operating.
Absolutely.
So it's kind of this legacy now gets to live on. I mean, the legacy keeps going and going and going, and you know, I mean, Destination Fear, Kindred Spirits isn't going anywhere. You know, it'll be archived somewhere. So, you know, somewhere down the road, somebody can look it up and go, yeah, I remember that building and blah, blah, blah. So I think that's what's even more important is that it's point in history is now being kind of told, and yes, we have something in 20, 30 years down the road that we can look at and be like, that there's old South Pittsburg Hospital.
And, you know, that place, up until the day it closed, that place was important to that area. There was, I know that, yeah, I had a medical emergency when I lived in that area and had to go to Winchester, which is a pretty mm-hmm. long ambulance ride, you know. So it's just one of those things that you don't realize just how much the center of a community's reality a hospital can be. I had never been more than, 10 or 15 minutes away from medical care. And right. I was hemorrhaging and 30 to 45 minutes by ambulance. So, yeah, it's a big deal to have medical care nearby. And
right. Well, and it's a big deal too, to have not only medical care, but it's also a big deal to have a facility that's owned by a community.
Yes.
And one of the things that was really special about South Pittsburgh is it was owned by the doctors who called Marion County their home. I mean, these were doctors who were, you know, born and raised. One of the doctors was a graduate from Vanderbilt University. You know, these were all doctors that were in the area. So, you know, it was very important to them to make sure that the hospital that they operated in and ran was good for the community that, you know, that they lived in, that they called their home. I mean, these are all people who, you know, South Pittsburgh is not a real big community. And, you know, when your next door neighbor comes in with a broken leg, you want to make sure that you can give your next door neighbor the best health care possible,
yes,
you know, because that's your neighbor.
And, absolutely.
And that, these kind of doctors and nurses and dietitians and everybody that was involved in South Pittsburgh, you know, some of these people work 19, 20 hours a day, you know, just nonstop. You know, it got to the point at the end where they were so understaffed that they were working their butts off. And, you know, that's something that my staff and I, you know, time and time again, we talk about, because, you know, healthcare's changed a lot. It's changed a lot. And these people put their hearts on the line. These people, you know, they sweat together. They were there hours upon hours upon hours, you know, helping the community that they called home. And, you know, when we do a tour or we do something like that, we stress how important these people were to their community and to everybody else. And like I said, that's part of the history of South Pittsburgh Hospital that we like to really pass on, because it was an incredible hospital that was owned,
yes,
and operated by, you know, a handful of people. And we're learning now that we have a couple of historians on the team, but we're learning that the community itself actually pitched in and they were helping financially. The hospital, when it went through a couple of expansions, fell short on money. So they went to the community and the community actually started pitching in money. I mean, you know, you have the guy down the road who doesn't make a whole lot of money, who was giving $100 here, $100 there, you know, for stuff that this hospital needed. And that's how tight this hospital was in the community. And I don't think that's something that you see a whole lot anymore these days. It was just such a unique type of hospital that everybody was vested into the hospital in the area. And like I said, the more and more we learn about the hospital and its history, the more and more my team and I are proud to be keeping that heritage going and telling people about the history and all the players that were very important in keeping the health of its community together. And like I said, it's just an amazing hospital. You know, beyond the paranormal, it was such a brilliant piece of history for Marion County and, you know, in Tennessee. And that's something that's real near and dear to my heart. I just think that's really kind of cool.
I think so too. And I'm going to read this on the air because you deserve to hear this. It's a positive. But Sherry says, not to mention the amount of blood, sweat, and tears you, Ronnie, and all her friends who are your volunteers put into this awesome location, and to get it up and running and so clean. I give you all huge props for all you guys did And we, the OSPH fans, are so thankful. So proud of your success. And you earned it. And you got three ghosts and a heart. That's your rating on that. Three ghosts and a heart. I think that's pretty awesome. So, oh,
thank you. I know that as a paranormal investigator, I've been doing it for quite some time. I enjoy what I do. I'm not really, to me, it's more of a hobby. It's, you know, it's more fun. I don't do it for the scientific value. I don't do it for, you know, there's a lot of really serious paranormal investigators out there who are trying to find answers. I do it because I love doing it. I think it's a lot of fun. But being a paranormal investigator, I've been to some locations that you just walk in and you're like, am I really allowed in here?
Right.
You're walking through a hallway and you're scared. I mean, you're literally scared for your life while you're doing a paranormal investigation. And
not because of the spirits.
No, just because of, you know, whatever, just the danger of the building. Yes. And when we took over Old South Pittsburgh Hospital, it was a pretty scary place. And you would know this, Kat, it was a pretty scary place to investigate.
Yeah.
There was a lot of garbage, a lot of water leaks, a lot of, you know, there was a lot of everything. And
I was there almost immediately before it closed.
Yeah.
So
you know, I mean, and we did. We as a team, you know, came together. We have all had a vision. We all had, you know, a requirement to be able to bring family members into that building, whether they're 10 years old or 60 years old, and not worry about anybody getting sick or getting hurt or tripping over something. And, you know, I mean, so we did. We moved 86 tons of garbage out of the building. We're still moving stuff out of the building.
That still astounds me.
But we did. We had a vision and we wanted to have a paranormal research center that people could come to and they could walk the halls and feel safe and enjoy the spirits and enjoy all that stuff. And I think we've accomplished a lot of what we wanted to do. And, you know, that's really on the backs of the team that we built, you know, and Daniel and Renee and Darla and Heath and the main core of people. You know, they're the ones who suggest, you know, we need this volunteer, we need that for volunteer. And we all come together and we all come out and we help each other. And we hope the dog's agreeing. We come together and we make sure that the building stays safe and stays healthy and stays a place where people want to come back time and time and time again and not have to worry about, you know, getting hurt or getting sick or anything like that. And, you know, we do that, especially, you know, a lot of the volunteers, like when I'm there, I spend 10, 12, 14, 16 hours there, you know, cleaning, fixing, doing that kind of stuff. I don't want to have to worry about, you know, my health when I'm in the building either. So, you know, that's something we did. We really cleaned her up. And anybody who has been there, you know, 5 years ago versus today, a lot of people don't even recognize the building. And, you know, I think one of the biggest compliments for myself and my team is when you have somebody who comes in and they're like, yeah, I was here in 2012 or 2015 or whatever year. And they're like, wow. And they're really just breathtaking. They just really stand back and they're like, the work that you and your team have done is just amazing. You know, and then we'll talk about some of the things that they remember seeing of how dangerous it was and how disgusting it was and that kind of stuff. And
I have to interrupt you.
Feel really good about what you did.
Because we have to go to break. And we will be right. Sorry about that. But we will be right back. Y'all come back too.
You are listening to WBHM, Digital Broadcasting, the best in paranormal talk, only on Paranormal Experience Radio, broadcasting live out of Birmingham, Alabama.
Oh, come on. I'm Southern, but... nope. That'll do. Hello. I am Kat Hobson, host of Paranormal Experience here on WBHM Digital Broadcasting out of Birmingham, Alabama. I enjoy having guests from all areas of the paranormal, from ghosts to ufology to cryptids and beyond. You'll find some of the best researchers in their fields bringing you some great information. Join me on Wednesday nights from 8 to 10 p.m. Eastern here on WBHM Digital Broadcasting.
Since 1948, Fate Magazine has brought you reports of the strange and unknown, all of them true. Fate Radio is carrying on that tradition, bringing you the unusual, macabre, strange, and bizarre. Join host Kat Hobson Sunday nights from 8 to 10 p.m. Eastern on WBHM Digital Broadcasting.
Listening to WBHM Digital Broadcasting, the best in paranormal talk, only on Paranormal Experienced Radio, broadcasting live out of Birmingham, Alabama.
I'm so sorry. Okay. I had to stop you.
I forgot what we were talking about anyway.
We were talking about mold and mildew and, you know, hot water heaters that have been, you know, set up all without permitting and stuff. Yeah. Lovely.
Yeah. Well, needless to say, we've got rid of all of that. And the building is, you walk in and it smells because Darla and Renee love Fabuloso.
Yes, they do.
I don't know why they like it so much.
It's a Southern woman thing. I love it too.
Is that what it is?
It is.
So you walk in now and you get that Fabuloso smell. You don't get that mildewy old building smell. I walk in and I'm always like, Fabuloso. And
yes.
Darla and Renee will kind of laugh at me. So, but yeah.
It's pretty interesting to see the difference.
The only time I've ever been insulted was I actually had somebody who walked up to me and said, and I was really dumbfounded, but they're like, I can't believe you did this. And I'm like, what are you talking about? She goes, all the creep factor is gone. You made the building too clean.
Too clean?
and I remember me and Daniel and Darla looking at each other going, I think our mouths just kind of fell out. We're like,
yes.
So you were the one who really liked walking over the piles of garbage everywhere?
Especially in the dining room?
Yeah. So I was like, you know, but here's the funny thing is they've been back 3 times since. So apparently it's creepy enough for them to continue to come back and do some investigating. So really nice people, but... Yeah, I guess they wanted the creep factor and we got rid of it.
Well, you know, I'm sorry, but dirt and grime and mold are not creep factors. They are health risks. And if a building is active, it doesn't have to be creepy. I actually feel that there's probably more activity because the people that actually worked there, patients who were there, you know, they would have more pride in their location. They would want to be there as opposed to being, and that might have been where some of the negativity was coming from, was people that had taken pride of place in their jobs or, you know, the doctors and the citizens who owned part of it. Yeah, they were probably angry that it was so derelict. And that was just simply the manager. That was simply the manager. And
Well, that is one of the things that we have noticed is that when I've been going to the South Pittsburgh Hospital long before I owned it. And I know, Kat, you'll probably agree with me, but you used to walk into the building and you used to feel dread. It used to feel like the bad end of a hospital. You know, in hospitals, we all know that they give life and they take life and they do everything in between. And when you walked into South Pittsburgh Hospital, you felt that heaviness on you. You felt that despair. You felt kind of the and I don't want to say the bad end of medicine, because there really isn't, but you felt that end of medicine of somebody's end of life, you know,
yes,
when they're terminal, or, you know what I'm saying? Now you kind of walk into old South Pittsburgh and it feels reborn. It feels like birth. It feels more exciting. It feels more happy. It feels, there's definitely a different feeling in the building. Mm-hmm. And I think you pretty much hit the nail on the head is that you've got a group of people in the building now who I think love this building so much, and they take such good care of it. And I think, like you said, I think the spirits, I think the community residents that are still left behind in the hospital, I think they recognize that. And I think they want their credit. They want to tell their story. They want people to understand that, you know what, our energy is in this building. We may have passed away, but the hours that we spent in this hospital saving lives, giving birth, doing things that were healthy to our community, that energy is still left behind. And that energy wants to be told.
Yes.
That spirit wants to be told. They want people to know that, you know what, the 20 hours a day that I put in this hospital didn't go for naught. It went to save lives. And I think, like you said, I think with the group of people that we have involved in the hospital now and the care and the love that they give to it, those individuals that spent their life in there saving lives are coming forward now and saying, hey, I'm here. You know, my energy is still in this building. And I want you to know that what's going on in this hospital now is what happened before, that there's people involved in the hospital who care. We'll never care as much as the people who save lives in that building. It's just, it would never happen, but we're close. I mean, we're as close as you can.
I would say that you're
as much about that building as they do.
Yeah. I would say that you are extraordinarily close.
And I think that they recognize that. And I think that they want their stories to be told. And I think that's why the building is as active as it is because when you've got something that's been around for 40, 50, you know, 60 years, that building has got a lot of energy ingrained in it, and it's got a lot of positive energy. And all we have to do is coax that positive energy out. So when people come to investigate, that energy is forefront, and you get to see that energy. And I think, like you said, I think that's why, you know, the page has been turned. I think the hospital is a happier, more joyous place. And like you and I talked about before the show, you know, in the paranormal world, you really need to be buddied up. You shouldn't be left alone. You should always do things in pairs. Old South Pittsburgh is one of those locations that I feel very comfortable walking down a dark hallway in the middle of the night and not worrying about being attacked by a spirit or being upset by a spirit. I feel very at ease and very calm. Now, do I feel somebody following behind me? Absolutely.
Oh, yeah.
But I've never felt to the point where I'm endangered or somebody was going to hurt me or somebody was going to throw me down the stairs or somebody. I always felt like somebody's got a story to tell me. And I think that if you talk to the volunteers, we spend so much time in that building. And a lot of times we do spend it alone. We spend it, you know, working in a room by ourselves or doing something like that. And I don't think any of our volunteers, including myself, have ever felt to the point where we're like, oh, got to get out of here. There's something that doesn't want me here. And I think that's a lot to do with the way that we care for the building and the way that we are all positive about telling the history and how great of a location it was. And like I said, those people want to talk. That energy wants to be known. It wants people to know what's going on in that building, and it wants its history to be spoken for. And you know, I've got 40 of the greatest history speakers in the world when we do an investigation in that building. And like I said, it's just, the building's just blossoming, and it's getting more and more active every day that we're there. I mean, it's just, it's amazing. And, you know, and the second part of the show, hopefully we'll get to some of that stuff, because
absolutely,
over the last 3 or 4 or 5 months, there has been some things that I just can't explain. And some of the things that we're seeing and hearing is happening on a regular occasion. It's happening daily. I mean, over and over. Wait till we tell you, Kat.
I can't wait. I'm so excited.
some of the things that are happening, I've been patted down. I've been asked to take my clothes off because they couldn't believe what they were seeing. And I'm like, nope, this isn't rigged. This is actually happening. But we'll save that for a little bit longer in the show so we can, you know, kind of keep people listening.
Well, you know, we have, we've got 5 minutes before we go to our news break, so we're okay. But I am so excited because when you left me while you had to run back into town and I was just wandering around, I was, other people started, you know, came, and which was fine with me because I was excited to meet so many people. Such good volunteers. I knew a lot, but I didn't know everyone. And when we were walking through, we had come out of that little chapel area and had checked in the restroom there just because I was running a recorder and I wanted to look around. And I got a fantastic EVP in there. And as we were walking out, I got an EVP outside. Like they had followed us, same voice. And, you know, it's just like they're so conversant. They're not trying to be, you know, get away or anything. It's just like, yeah, so what you doing? You know, that seems to be the attitude now. It's so awesome. And, and it's, I agree. They are reacting with such positivity to what y'all are doing. It's beautiful.
We run recorders quite a bit. And, it's amazing. We'll be standing around having a meeting, or we'll be standing around talking about this, that, whatever, with the recorder running. And you can actually hear voices on the recorder adding their 10 cents to our conversation. And I mean, one of the things that is astounding about OSPH is that, you know, we look for Class A EVPs, the ones where you don't have to enhance the audio.
Yes.
You just literally can hear the voices. And OSPH does that. And we have had so many instances where Leanne and I will be standing, we'll be talking on the second floor nurses station, and we'll just be having a conversation with a voice recorder going, and you play it back and you hear somebody correcting you. Like, you said something wrong, and you'll hear a voice on the EVP, and you look at it, we'll look at each other like, did we really just hear that? We had the maintenance guy in the building. His name is Art. We're walking through the building and we're doing we have the recorder going the whole time. You can hear people actually saying hi to him and welcoming him back into the building. This is a man who hasn't been in the building in like 15, 20 years.
Wow.
And you can actually get Class A EVPs of people welcoming him back into the building. And you play it back for Art, he's like, oh my gosh. And what's even scarier is when you play it back for Art and he's like, I know that voice.
Yes.
He
I was like, going to ask you that.
Identify some of, yeah, he could actually identify some of the voices that he's hearing on the EVPs. And that is just phenomenal. I mean, that is just, you just stand back and just in litter.
That's
awe,
just like, oh
wow.
My gosh. I mean,
yes,
it's the coolest thing I've ever heard. I mean, because, you know, you get the voices that you hear over and over, you know that they're attached to that location because they're always there. You always get them. But to actually have someone on site who can identify the voices, know who those individuals are, is unheard of.
That's amazing. And to have him hear. So we were playing back some of the EVPs and he would hear noises that were going on in the building. And he'd say, it was the elevator. He could actually identify some of the noises that the hospital made while it was
operating.
Gosh.
And you
just look at him and you're just like, yeah, you look at him and you're like, he's like, yep, that's the elevator. I'm like, wow. So, you know, what's neat is it makes all those claims of the paranormal investigators, it makes those claims realistic. And it just proves that there's energy beyond what we know, because you have somebody who's living and breathing and walking the halls of a place that he called home for many years of his life and has the ability to actually identify some of the things that were going on while the hospital was open.
Unreal. I am so excited to get back up there. But we have to go. This is our top of the hour news break. So there it is. And I always hope for a little good news. You know, I'm ever hopeful. So maybe today's the day. I don't know. I haven't been still long enough to find out about news today. So if you're not so inclined, feel free to grab your stein, your coffee cup, your mug, whatever. Fill it up and meet us back here. We'll be back after the news. Y'all come back too.
Support for NPR comes from Sattva, the comfort company. Sattva luxury mattresses are sold online and priced at about 50% less than mattress stores. Visit sattva.com/NPR today and save an additional $225.
Live from NPR News, I'm Janine Herbst. After many Texans got huge electric bills after last week's winter storm, Texas Governor Greg Abbott today says the Texas Utilities Commission, for now, will stop sending out bills and there will be a moratorium on disconnects for non-payment. Meanwhile, as Texas thaws out, the state's water utilities are slowly coming back online. But as Texas Public Radio's Jerry Clayton reports, millions are still without regular water service.
Portions of major Texas cities, including Dallas, Houston, and San Antonio, have restored some water service, yet millions of people across the state are still under boil water notifications. Many of those are expected to be rescinded early this week. In San Antonio, as of Sunday afternoon, more than 90% of water service had been restored, but about half the city was still under a boil water notice. Municipalities, in many cases, are waiting for the Texas Commission on Environmental Quality to test water supplies. City and county governments, along with many nonprofit organizations, continue to hand out water to residents across the state. I'm Jerry Clayton in San Antonio.
President Biden's nearly $2 trillion coronavirus relief package goes before Congress this week. As NPR's Barbara Sprunt reports, Democrats hope to include a minimum wage increase to $15 an hour.
Democratic Congresswoman Pramila Jayapal told CNN she believes the fight to increase the minimum wage is a fight worth having.
If we're going to be real about tackling racial inequity, economic inequity, then we are going to have to raise the minimum wage.
President Biden has said he supports the measure, but is doubtful it can be passed through the Senate reconciliation process that only needs 51 votes. Progressives argue the measure would affect the federal budget and therefore falls within the rules of reconciliation. The Senate parliamentarian hasn't yet decided whether that's the case. But two moderate Senate Democrats, Joe Manchin of West Virginia and Kyrsten Sinema of Arizona, have already indicated they won't support using reconciliation to increase the wage to that level. Barbara Sprunt, NPR News.
The British government says every adult in the UK will be offered a first dose of the vaccine by the end of July. NPR's Jackie Northam reports.
Prime Minister Boris Johnson says the accelerated target for vaccination will allow vulnerable people to be protected sooner. About one-third of British adults, almost 17 million people, have already been vaccinated. Under the new target, everyone over 50 or with an underlying health condition can be vaccinated by mid-April. The government has faced harsh criticism for its handling of the pandemic, which has left more than 120,000 people dead, the highest toll in Europe. A new variant earlier this year forced the UK's third lockdown, and Johnson is under pressure to reopen schools and businesses to help the economy, which has been battered by the pandemic. Jackie Northam, NPR News, Washington.
This is NPR News. Thousands of protesters marched in Myanmar again today, denouncing the February 1st military coup and calling for elected leader Aung San Suu Kyi to be released. Yesterday, security forces fired on protesters in Mandalay, killing two people. Peaceful demonstrations were held in that city today. The military has been unable to stop the demonstrations and the civil disobedience campaign of strikes against the coup, even with a promise of new elections and warnings against dissent. The U.S. says it's deeply concerned by the violence. The damage from the winter storm and extreme cold isn't only in Texas. After nearly a week of freezing temperatures, farmers in Mississippi and Louisiana say they have lost livestock and crops. Stephen Basaha from member station WBHM has more.
Farmers in both states have lost thousands of chickens as ice caused their shelters to collapse. Mississippi cattle farmer Carolyn Jones says she's lost at least seven of her cattle.
All of this will stress an animal, and once that animal is stressed, then we're losing dollars because you're losing pounds.
With pipes and ponds freezing, farmers are also worrying about cattle dying from dehydration. Louisiana farmers are concerned the frozen earth may have killed their sugarcane crop, but won't find out for several weeks. If the roots do not sprout, the Louisiana Farm Bureau Federation says the state's farmers could end up losing millions of dollars. For NPR News, I'm Stephen Basaha in Birmingham.
The average price of a gallon of regular gas is on the rise, jumping 14 cents over the past 2 weeks to $2.64 a gallon, according to the Lundberg survey. I'm Janine Herbst, and you're listening to NPR News.
Welcome back to WBHM Digital Broadcasting out of Birmingham, Alabama. The time is 5 minutes after the hour.
Welcome back for the second hour of Paranormal Experience Radio. It's the ghouls shake their chains there. I am so glad y'all are here because we are having a good time. This is Ronnie Dee, who is the owner of Old South Pittsburg Hospital. He is a paranormal investigator in his own right, and he is just a fantastic guy. Welcome back.
Well, thanks for having me back. Apparently, I didn't bore you that much the first hour. We're going to do a second hour, huh?
I am a glutton for a good time, I'm going to tell you. So I am thrilled. We do have Kylie the Wonder Lab joining us, and apparently she has never seen a bowl of water in her life. So there's that. I apologize, Ronnie. But if you've ever had a thirsty Wonder Lab, then they just have to do their thing.
Oh, yeah. My little baby, I have a little Shih Tzu Maltese who's sitting on my lap, too, because I'm actually eating a beef sandwich and some cheese fries, and she's got to have her portion of my dinner, too. So,
well, absolutely. And, yeah, Kylie used to be a 70-pound lap baby, and now she is a mere shadow of her former self. Everybody keeps talking about how young she is. I'm like, she's 10, almost 11, but thanks. So it's, ketoacidosis. She has diabetes and she just suddenly started dropping weight. And now she's just pretty much perfect. So, yeah. Maybe that's why we like each other. We both are nuts for dogs and treat them as children.
Yes. Yeah, I would rather spend the afternoon with my dog in spirit than most human beings, unfortunately.
I understand. I have four, and, you know, they're just really very, very loving. They all do that. So
Unconditional love. No matter what you do, if you forget to give them water, they still love you.
Or if you squirt them with the water bottle because they're being rude, they still love you. Mm-hmm. Confused, but they love you.
Oh, yeah.
Now, I am going to hold you to this because you said that you were going to start sharing some of the experiences, new and old, but I'm interested in the take on the new as much as I am the old.
Okay, so I don't even know where to begin. But I would say we have a young lady, her name is Leanne Rogers, who's part of our team. Her, Darla, and Ashley have done a lot of history, have really gotten into learning the history of the hospital, but more importantly, learning the doctors and the nurses and the people who have really, really made OSPH what it was back then in terms of medical care. And one of the doctors, which is an original doctor, his name is Dr. Taylor. Guy was just amazing. He actually graduated from Vanderbilt University in the top of his class. Wrote lots of medical papers and was one of the founding fathers of the hospital. We did a lot of research on him. They did a lot of research on them. I just kind of read the coattails of their research. But Leanne had the actual opportunity to talk to his daughter and trying to get his daughter to come into the hospital. One thing that's really peculiar about Dr. Taylor is back in the old days before, I guess, we realized that smoking was bad, Dr. Taylor used to spend a lot of his times in the hallways of Old South Pittsburg Hospital smoking a pipe. There's many, many pictures that are documented with Dr. Taylor with a pipe. We've got two or three pictures on the wall of him in the hospital currently with him holding a pipe. And kind of talking to some of the people that he treated, he used his pipe as kind of a mechanical device that when you weren't doing what the man wanted you to do, he would take his hand and open it up and beat his pipe in the palm of his hand and say, "I told you, blah, 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 blah."
Oh, wow.
He used that pipe quite a bit to kind of really stress his medical expertise on people who weren't following exactly what he wanted them to do. During meetings, he would smoke the pipe, and when he was exclaiming what he wanted done, he would do the same thing. He'd take that pipe and he kind of beat it in his hand, and "I'm telling you, this is the way I want it done." Kind of like what my dad used to do to my behind with his hand when I didn't do what he told me to do. But he would use that pipe as kind of an enforcing tool to make people pay attention and listen to him. So about 5 or 6 months ago, I don't know, maybe it's 7 months ago now, we started to begin to smell a really, really sweet, unique smell in the building. It was something that none of us had heard or seen before, or heard or smelled, or I should say smelled or seen before, sorry. And all of a sudden it started appearing, and the smell became more and more and more regular and more strong, to the point where now we actually believe that Dr. Taylor is a very frequent resident of the hospital. We will have public investigations. We'll have private investigations. And a good example is we had one kind of a little back story is JB Coates and I, we are part of a team. So when we do public investigations, we break up the hospital into four separate locations. Anybody who's been there knows that the hospital is pretty big, and there's four different areas of the hospital that we utilize. And JB and I do our investigation, and we do it in what's called the Tri-City Clinic. It's the oldest part of the hospital. It's the area where Dr. Taylor spent the most amount of his time. It's where he helped sick people. It's where he birthed people, because the nursery used to be down there as well, too. We do an investigation that's in the Tri-City emergency waiting area. And a couple of months ago, probably five or six months ago now, we were doing an investigation. It was myself and JB. And all of a sudden, we got that really strong smell of smoke. And one of the girls that was with us actually turned her flashlight on to look to see what it was, because we kind of thought something was on fire. It was that strong that we thought that somebody was smoking something in there, or there was, you know, like that sweet smell of when you have an electrical fire or something like that. We weren't sure where it came from. Well, lo and behold, when she turns her flashlight on, you see this big cloud of smoke. Kat, I'm telling you, all looked at each other and physically see it. You could see it like it was rolling out of somebody's mouth. I think there was 12 of us, plus myself and JB, and we all stopped to look at each other like, what did we just witness?
Exactly.
It was indescribable. Like I said, this was the first time that I think we all experienced it, where it was the actual smoke. We experienced the smell. We experienced that type of part of the paranormal experience. But this time, we all got to witness the smoke. And it was so thick and so dense that it literally looked like somebody just blew pipe smoke out of their mouth. One of the girls that was in the group was smart enough to get a bunch of pictures. She took a bunch of pictures. We all kind of stood around just in awe, just really in awe. So as soon as the smoke arrives, it disappears. It's gone. You know, once again, we're doing a paranormal investigation, so we're in the dark. So I believe that we were doing the Estes method. We were doing it pardon me, in the body box, and went about doing the investigation, got some really good Estes stuff going on there. And all of a sudden, one of my volunteers starts choking. And we're all like, you know, are you okay? Are you okay? Well, once again, we turn the flashlight on, and the smoke was so thick around this young lady that she was actually having a hard time breathing because it was there. It was that sweet smell of pipe smoke. And it looked like Dr. Taylor literally blew it in the face of our volunteer.
Good and heavens.
We were all just taken back. It was the most, in all of the years I have been doing this, I have never seen something that was so profound and so, there's just, I'm even talking about it, I don't know how to describe it because it literally looked like somebody turned on a smoke machine. It was that thick and it was that dense. So we went on to do our paranormal investigation. And so we move over to different parts of the building and do our thing, blah, blah, blah. Well, we bring the second group. So we do, everything's done in fours. So we usually break groups up into four. And then so JB and I, we get another group of people. We do the same investigation over again. So JB and I bring our new group of people into the Tri-City Clinic emergency room waiting area. And we're all sitting. We do the same thing. It's kind of an Estes experiment. Then all of a sudden, there's the smell again. Turn the flashlight on, and there is the smoke again.
Oh, my gosh.
Like it was like once again, it was there. So we're all just like I said, JB and I couldn't get over the fact that what we were seeing was actually happening. And the thing is we were with a second group of people. It wasn't the same group as before. So, you know, being a paranormal investigator and asking questions, we're like, first thing we thought was, you know, the first time, maybe it was one of our guests. Maybe it was, you know, you go through kind of that whole myriad of what are we seeing? What are we witnessing?
Exactly.
We're on 6 or 7 months. And I will tell you, Kat, this happens every investigation.
Good heavens.
We have it happen every time. And what we're now, it's advanced so much that we had a group, we had one of a very well-known group of investigators from Tennessee come out to the building. They were doing their investigation and we were kind of bragging about it. We were talking about how it's happening. It's happening on a regular occasion. It's happening at public investigations. I mean, it's like clockwork. I mean, it's literally like clockwork. Well, as we're talking about it, the leader of this paranormal group from Tennessee is filming and there's the smoke just appears out of nowhere, followed by the smell.
Oh my
gosh. He just looks at us and he was just in awe.
No
and
doubt.
He was like, oh my gosh. And I was like, this is something that's happening on a regularly. So to take it a step further, we were at the hospital. It was a couple of months ago. One of the volunteers and I were, I was actually on the phone and the volunteer was in the car. And I'm talking on the phone. I was actually taking an overnight investigation. And all of a sudden the volunteer comes flying out of the car. And I'm like, what's wrong? What's wrong? Dr. Taylor sitting in the car with me. And I'm like,
oh,
stop it.
Heavens.
So I open up the car door and the smoke comes billowing out of the car, literally billowing out of the car.
Oh my gosh.
And I was like, holy cow. So it's happening in the building. It's happening in the building and it's happening outside of the building. And Dr. Taylor is wanting to tell his story. So one of the things that's really funny is that we are in a residential facility, you know, or residential
yes.
area. There's houses everywhere. This was in the middle of the afternoon. You know, I want to say it was probably a Friday, Saturday afternoon. So here I am, standing in front of a car with a car door opening, talking to the air saying, Dr. Taylor, you need to get back in your building. We're going to the store. We'll be right back. And there's people walking down the road, watching me talk to a car. And I was just like, oh, I will tell you what was really fascinating is that I told Dr. Taylor to go back in the building. that we were going to run to the store, we'd be right back. We never smelled that smoke again in the car, ever.
Wow.
What's really, really fascinating is now, the last Friday we had an investigation. This was, what, 3 weeks ago, 3.5 weeks ago now. JB, myself, and a couple other volunteers were actually in the Tri-City Clinic ER waiting area. We were doing the same thing. We were doing the Estes experiment. There was a group of so myself and Sam were actually leaning up against the door, watching the Estes experiment go on while JB was running it. And then one of the other volunteers was actually sitting on the floor, and she was sitting towards kind of closer towards JB. But we were kind of, the three of us were in a triangle so that we were all kind of facing in the same direction. And lo and behold, Sam looked at me and I looked at Sam and I'm like, did somebody just like, is there somebody standing in front of us? And Sam goes, I don't think so. And so Sam and I both saw a shadow figure standing right in front of us. When Sam went to go turn her light on, the shadow figure had disappeared, but the smoke remained. And it was the wildest thing I have ever seen. Oh, yes.
Oh,
Sam and I looked at each other.
We got to go. But tell me, what did you do?
Oh, no. Panicked, ran down the hall because we couldn't believe what we just saw.
Get out.
No.
That would not happen to you.
Sam and I looked at each other because we both looked at each other because it was kind of, to be really honest with you, it was almost a tear jerking moment. We have been trying to get Dr. Taylor to do something other than blow smoke.
Yes.
And we think that he's finally getting the manifestation down a little bit more. What was really unique is this was the third round of our investigation. So we had a fourth round to go after this.
Uh-huh.
After Dr. Taylor did this, during the fourth round, he didn't show up the rest of the night. So we, after the investigation was over, Sam and I had, we were talking in JB, and we were talking about the fact that we believe that Dr. Taylor is becoming more and more strong and getting to be able to use his manifestation abilities. We think that it took him a lot of energy to actually manifest
yes.
into a figure. And that was the reason why he didn't make the fourth trip or on our fourth round.
Yes.
That fourth round, we did not see him the rest of the night.
After we had sat down and talked about it,
we had looked at his pictures. What we all believe we saw fit the same body shape, the same type as what we believe Dr. Taylor looked like while he was living. So we think that it took him 6 or 7 months to actually be able to do what he did. But I think he gave us a glimpse into him being able to become even a more potent resident of the hospital. And like
yes.
I said, it's still happening to this very day. So I know we need to go to a break, so I'll let you take a break.
So we will be right back. Y'all come back too.
You are listening to WBHM Digital Broadcasting, Birmingham, Alabama.
Oh, come on. I'm Southern, but... nope.
That'll do. Hello, I am Kat Hobson, host of Paranormal Experience here on WBHM Digital Broadcasting out of Birmingham, Alabama. I enjoy having guests from all areas of the paranormal, from ghosts to ufology to cryptids and beyond. You'll find some of the best researchers in their fields bringing you some great information. Join me on Wednesday nights from 8 to 10 p.m. Eastern here on WBHM Digital Broadcasting.
Thank you.
You are listening to WBHM, Digital Broadcasting, the best in paranormal talk only on Paranormal Experience Radio. Broadcasting live out of Birmingham, Alabama.
Since 1948, Fate Magazine has brought you reports of the strange and unknown, all of them true. Fate Radio is carrying on that tradition, bringing you the unusual, macabre, strange, and bizarre. Join host Kat Hobson Sunday nights from 8 to 10 p.m. Eastern on WBHM Digital Broadcasting.
You are listening to WBHM Digital Broadcasting, the best in paranormal talk, only on Paranormal Experience Radio, broadcasting live out of Birmingham, Alabama.
This is Jason Bland, host of Midwest Paranormal Presents Paranormal Soup, where we stream live as a webcast every Sunday night, 11 p.m. to 2 a.m. Eastern, with guests who will blow your mind. Live ghost box sessions where you can call into the show to see if the spirits will talk to you, and the World Wide Web of Weird with the latest in paranormal news and evidence. We're bringing the weird every Sunday night, 11 p.m. to 2 a.m. Eastern, on our Facebook page and YouTube channel. Don't forget to follow and subscribe.
Thank you for listening to WBHM Digital Broadcasting out of Birmingham, Alabama. The time is 23 minutes after the hour.
Welcome back to Paranormal Experience with Kat Hobson. I'm so glad you're here, and I hope that you're enjoying my guest, Ronnie Dee, as much as I am, because if so, you are having a howling good time. So, Ronnie, I appreciate you being here, and I appreciate you sharing your experiences, but you know, I always laugh because there's so much in Beetlejuice that you can actually almost imagine new ghosts going through. You know, the growing pains, as it were, if they don't read their handbook for the, you know, newly departed, but recently deceased. But it sounds like that's what was happening with the doctor, that he wasn't sure how to manifest other than his smoke, and now he is developing a skill set.
I really hope that's true, because, oh my gosh, we have so many questions for him. So hopefully as time goes by, he'll like I said, I mean, he was one of the founding doctors of the hospital. So it would just be amazing if, you know, if there was that opportunity to communicate, and for him to give us some EVPs in terms of, you know, what it was like when the hospital was, you know, operating and that kind of stuff. And just amazing that his energy is still in the building. I mean, it's just, and like I said, I've been doing this for, you know, 18 years now, and I've never had an experience like that before. It was breathtaking. And I think the thing that's most breathtaking is that it's happened probably the last 6-7 public investigation we've had. So we're talking, you know, maybe 400-600 people who have all seen this phenomena happen. And one of the kind of the jokes is that we did have a public investigation one evening, and there was a gentleman who was a skeptic. He walked in the door, you know, and I don't blame people. They, you know, a lot of times either their wives or their husbands drag them to these events because one of them believes and the other one thinks it's whatever. And we did, we had a skeptic come in. His wife, you know, was a big TV watcher, wanted to come, you know, and he was just dragged in the building. Literally, you could see the chip on his shoulder when he was, you know, when we were doing the whole conversation. And so he got to experience that smoke. And it was funny because we're in the Tri-City Clinic, and he's looking, you know, he's looking up in the ceiling, he's looking up on the floor, he looked at me, he looked at the volunteers, he asked me to take my clothes off in front of everybody. I'm like, I'll, you know, we need to go to the bathroom and you need to pat me down. Or, I mean, I'm like, this is not coming from me. And I said, and furthermore, you know, you can see the direction of the way that the smoke is coming, because it's got a definite, you know, when somebody blows smoke out their mouth, it's got a directional flow.
Yes.
And if we time it right, where we actually get the flashlight to go, as soon as we get the smell, you can see the volume of the smoke and the direction that it's going. And sometimes you can even see it kind of rolling. And this gentleman got to see that direction. And I said, that smoke was coming at me. It wasn't coming away from me. It wasn't falling from the ceiling. It wasn't rising from the floor. You know, it was happening, you know, about 5, 6, 5, 7, 5, 8 in the air. You know, I mean, it's manifesting there. And, you know, he did everything in his power to debunk it, which, great job. I mean, that's what we're here to do. We're, you know, you want to try to debunk something like that. You know, turned the flashlight off, went back to the investigation, got more smoke, and he saw it the second time. He's like, I can't explain this. And I said, dude, I said, we can't explain this. And this happens to us on a daily. You know, we're dumbfounded. We're literally to the point where we're there's no explanation for this. I mean, absolutely none. After the investigation was over and he was walking out the door, he took me aside and he says, you know what? He says, Ronnie, he says, wife dragged me to this, wasn't sure what to make of it. He says, I'm going to tell you, I said, I'm not a skeptic anymore. He says, whatever is in this building, whether it's a spirit, whether it's energy, whatever you want to call it, he says, this is cool. This is really, wow. You know, beyond the scope of what I could have imagined. And, you know, and I told him, I said, even with me, I said, you know, I've been doing this a long time. And even me, I'm very skeptical. I mean, there's still a lot of things that I don't really know what to believe. I said, but we've had some experiences in this building where you can't explain it. I mean, Daniel and I were up on the third floor looking for a water main. We couldn't find the water main. And Daniel, just for a goof, goes, hey, can anybody help us find the water main? And you hear a voice on the other end of the third floor that says, it's over here. Oh, Daniel, wow. And I are in the building alone on the third floor. So, you know, we walk over to where we hear that voice, and Daniel pulls the ceiling tile down because the guy is so tall. I mean, he just reaches up there and grabs it, moves it over while I'm grabbing a ladder. And sure enough, there's the water main. And he comes down, you know, he's like, hey, thank you. And you hear, you're welcome. And then you hear footsteps walking away from us. And Daniel and I are looking at it, like, did that really just happen? You're really just in awe. And I mean, you know, Renee has been part of the team since the day I bought the hospital and even beforehand. And the stories that they just tell about the hospital, whether it's, you know, a shadow figure, a full body apparition, disembodied voices. I mean, it's something new every day. And it's just amazing. I just have never been in a location that has just been as active as this location is. And what I find really fascinating is that we try and do a very happy balance between public investigations and private investigations, because we want teams to be able to come in and do their own, you know, their own investigation. But we also want to do public investigations, and we want to do those with people who, you know, don't have a team, don't have the money to rent the building by themselves. So they'll come and they'll be part of a public investigation. And a lot of these people come in and they've never experienced paranormal before. They've never had that experience. And they leave at the end of the night going, wow, like, I don't know what to believe. Like, and I think that is kind of our job as building owners, as volunteers, is to make people think about it. They don't have to believe.
I agree.
They don't have to walk out the door. They don't have to walk out the door going, oh yeah, there's ghosts, there's spirits, there's this, there's that. We have to let them walk out the door thinking, I just saw something that was supernatural. I saw something that I can't explain.
Yes.
And then whether or not they decide to move forward and become a paranormal investigator, or whether or not they decide to just chalk it up as, oh, that was fun, and that's part of my life. It's done. It's over with. And it's cool. That is what our job is to do as a building owner, as volunteers, is to introduce people into something that they may not know is out there. And we have the perfect building because that building doesn't seem to let a lot of people down. And like I said, some of the amazing things that we get is just phenomenal.
I have never been disappointed there. It is, to me, it's really astounding that that's the case, because normally you're not going to consistently get activity that is repetitious by, you know, by visit. You know, it is just not, that's not something that happens much. I wanted to ask you, because I've found this to be true in other locations, and a friend of mine was telling me that this is something that happens in hers all the time, but it is weather related. You know, I have always thought that if you have paranormal locations, that, you know, storms and the energy built by those would help the spirits get a boost, as it were. But at her location, which is a jail, and, you know, the building is a lot of metal and a lot of power, it flattens the activity. Do you find that the weather has any effect at all on Old South Pittsburgh?
That's actually kind of a unique question. And that's something that we, you know, I have questioned myself, because I've been to the hospital. I'm at the hospital a lot of times with some of Tennessee's worst thunderstorms, where there's, mm-hmm. you know, all sorts of lightning and everything going on. And I find that I agree with her. I think that when we have a really big storm and there's a lot of energy in the air, I think that our building becomes a little less active. I don't know why. And this is just, I can't speak for everybody who's been in the building before, right. But me personally, I haven't had as much energy when there's a storm there. Now, I will tell you, the hospital, our hospital in particular, our hospital gets really excited and really energy bound when we've got a group of people who are in the hospital who are enthusiastic.
Yes.
We can tell when we do a public investigation, as an example. JB is really good at this. She's a cheerleader. She gets people up and going. She gets the energy kind of, you know, going. When we have a group of 40 people in the hospital and they're energetic and they're excited and they can't wait to get going, those nights are the nights that we absolutely have incredible activity. When we've got a group of people in the building who are kind of melancholy and kind of non-believers and kind of skeptical, we have energy, we have activity, but it's nowhere near as off the hook as it is when we get the energy from the people. I think that spirits, just like me or you, we were talking about this earlier, you know, you go to a concert, there's a lot of energy in music. There's a lot of energy in a crowd. There's a lot of energy in that kind of a thing. And as a human being, we thrive off of that energy. I mean, we thrive off of each other. We thrive off of that band that's on the stage that's, you know, singing at the top of their lungs and all that other kind of stuff. And I think spirits are no different than that. I mean, if we're in the building and we're giving them energy and we're exciting them to communicate, they want to communicate. They want to be part of that energy. You know, if you go to a concert and the group's not very good or whatever, and the crowd is a little melancholy and the group's not really performing very well, you don't have that same experience at the concert that you would with a group that's energetic and exciting to be on stage.
True.
And I think the spirits are kind of that same way. And I think that maybe environmental forces can give them that energy, but I really, really think it's dependent on the people that are in the building.
Yes.
And the energy that they're giving back to them. Because let's face it, I mean, if you and I are having a conversation and I'm watching TV and, you know, you're telling me how your day was and I'm not really paying attention, you're not as enthusiastic about telling me your day. Whereas if we're sitting there face to face and joking around and we're talking about how your day went and how you love the beach and all that other stuff, you tell that story more enthusiastically. You feel better about communicating that with me. Well, the spirits, I feel, are the same way. If we're involved in them and we want to hear them, they're keying into our energy, and that's allowing them to tell their story. And I think that, like I said, and I think that as a human being, our brain puts out a lot of energy, our bodies put out a lot of energy. And I think that's more important than anything environmentally. Now, I could be really wrong, but that's just kind of my feeling on it.
I don't think you're wrong. I think that that's the case because I was actually at Sloss for an event that was a large event. And in fact, Adam and Joe Chin were the people that were, you know, the talent for it. So I'm sitting there looking out. We're in this metal structure, open-sided, with all kinds of metal inside it, where we are, handrails all over the place, and Birmingham is having a lightning storm to beat the band. And I was just like, I'm out. You know, I am not standing here. But, you know, eventually it went, it calmed down, and it, you know, it was a pretty good investigation, but you know, in the tunnels from the rain, the tunnels at Sloss always flood, and you know, it's just icky after it rains. And that was back when they liked paranormal investigators, right? They do not like us now, but they won't allow public hunts. So, but you know, it's free to get in because it's a national monument, and I've seen and caught more evidence during the day than I ever have at night there. So if you're wanting to go and visit Sloss, go during the day, take your equipment, go down to the boiler room because you're going to get something there guaranteed almost. So,
well, but that's something that I find that we've been doing at the hospital too, is we've been doing a lot of daytime tours, and there's just a few of us that we let do the daytime tours, and some of the evidence that they're getting during the daytime is rivaling the nighttime stuff.
I'm sure.
I mean, just amazing. So yeah, so I understand where you're going with that.
I would love to come and do Old South Pittsburg in a tour environment during the day because I think that would be great. But we have to take our last break. If you have questions, get them in chat because, you know, this is going to be your final segment chance. We will be right back after this, and y'all come back too.
You're listening to WBHM, Digital Broadcasting, the best in paranormal talk, only on Paranormal Experience Radio, broadcasting live out of Birmingham, Alabama.
Oh, come on. I'm Southern, but... nope.
That'll do. Hello. I am Kat Hobson, host of Paranormal Experience here on WBHM Digital Broadcasting out of Birmingham, Alabama. I enjoy having guests from all areas of the paranormal, from ghosts to ufology to cryptids and beyond. You'll find some of the best researchers in their fields bringing you some great information. Join me on Wednesday nights from 8 to 10 p.m. Eastern here on WBHM Digital Broadcasting.
Since 1948, Fate Magazine has brought you reports of the strange and unknown, all of them true. Fate Radio is carrying on that tradition, bringing you the unusual, macabre, strange, and bizarre. Join host Kat Hobson Sunday nights from 8 to 10 p.m. Eastern on WBHM Digital Broadcasting.
Listening to WBHM, Digital Broadcasting, the best in paranormal talk, only on Paranormal Experienced Radio, broadcasting live out of Birmingham, Alabama.
Welcome back to the final segment of Paranormal Experienced. I am Kat Hobson, your host, and my guest is Ronnie Dee. If you have any questions for him, this is the time to put them in chat. I am just absolutely, oh, we have a question. What is your second place you've ever investigated, if you've done others? What happened there?
Probably the second place that's near and dear to my heart, and I tell everybody this when they ask me, is it's a little place called Hillview Manor out in Newcastle, Pennsylvania.
Yeah.
My daughter and I were actually on a paranormal investigation there, and my daughter got to see my daughter actually got to see a full bodied apparition before I did.
Oh, wow.
And, I remember we were actually on the second floor. If you're looking down the corridor, Hillview Manor, actually, when it was a poor farm, had a segregated men's cafeteria and a ladies' cafeteria. My daughter was actually setting up a camera that was shooting into the men's cafeteria. And I remember looking at her, and her face just turned white. And I said, honey, what's wrong? And she says, Daddy, there's a man in here with us. And I'm like, no, baby, it's just me and you. There's nobody else. We're setting up cameras. And she says, Daddy, there's a man in here. And as I come walking, she says, he just disappeared. And my daughter, it was amazing. My daughter actually and I did a lot of investigating together. She started at a very early age. But that was her first experience with a full body apparition. And that was the day she became addicted to it as well. She's still involved in the hobby. And that's probably my second favorite location. I really, really enjoyed that. So anybody out there who wants to go to a location, Hillview Manor out in Newcastle, Pennsylvania is one of my favorites.
Well, Sherry said that she's from Newcastle and her parents still live there. So she looks like a trip to see mom and dad and Hillview Manor.
Road trip.
So I think that's terrific.
I'm so in, Sherry.
Yes, no doubt. I'm in. But I have a question for you relevant to the topic of your daughter. There is a growing group of adolescents who are being, you know, praised as the new generation of paranormal investigators from 12 to 15, roughly. What do you think of people that age or younger being allowed to participate in investigations?
I'm going to be ridiculed for this because I know I have been in the past, but this is my thought.
Oh, that's what I'm asking
both of
for.
My daughters got involved very early. I'm a firm believer that spirits are everywhere. That
yes.
If you go into an active hospital, if you buried a loved one in a cemetery, you know, if you go to the battlegrounds at Gettysburg, there are spirits everywhere. It doesn't matter where you are, whether you're going to Old South Pittsburgh Hospital, Waverly, Newcastle, it doesn't make a difference. My philosophy or my thought is, why not get our children involved in it so they can handle that type of a thing? We, as children, from my understanding, I've never been gifted. I've never had some of the gifts that other people have. But one of the things that people have always said is that children at an early age can see spirits. They can interact with ghosts. They can interact with that kind of a thing. Why aren't we teaching our children not to be afraid of them? Why aren't we teaching our children how to handle the spirits, how to interact, how to do things with the spirits so that when they go to bed at night, they're not looking under their beds, that they're not fearful of those kind of a thing. I'm not a real big believer that there's a lot of demonic activity in the world or malevolent spirits out there. That's not saying that there aren't, because I'm sure there are. I'm sure that there's documented cases of that. But I would say the majority of the time, the spirits that we're interacting with are dead relatives, are people who haven't crossed over, are people like our residents at the hospital that have a story to tell, that have something more that they want to communicate with you. So why aren't we teaching our children not to be fearful of that? Why aren't we teaching our children how to handle that? Why aren't we teaching them to become paranormal investigators, to question supernatural, to push our industry or push our hobby further, quicker? Like I said, my children have been doing it since they were very young age. We've never brought anything home with us. My children have never been in danger. My children have never had, you know, any situations that, you know, that we even remotely felt uncomfortable with. So I, you know, and even at Old South Pittsburgh, when we do a public investigation, we allow children in the building as long as they're with their parent, because I believe that we need to teach them that type of a thing, and we need to teach them not to be afraid of it. Now, that on the converse, if something does negative happen, they now have the tools to go to somebody like a Casey Scruggs or somebody who knows how to handle an attachment or handle something that could be negative. They've got that avenue now to utilize to try and get rid of that attachment. But I think the majority of the time when we're doing paranormal investigating, you know, we're in contact with good spirits, good wholesome spirits that have a story to tell, that have something to share, that want us to understand what the hospital was like when it was open. And why not allow our children to be part of that? Because if they're going to get an attachment or they're going to come across something that is going to be bad, they could pick that up just by going to a cemetery, burying their grandparents, or going to a hospital to visit a loved one who, you know, just came out of the emergency room with COVID or anything like that. So, like I said, I think if we teach our children how to utilize their gifts or how to utilize some of the things that we're doing as adults, can it really hurt? I don't believe it can.
Cool. That's a very good answer. With a lot of pressure.
Did I win the prize?
No prize, but it was pretty great, right? I just thought that...
I just think, like I said, I think it's something that, you know, in today's day and age with social media and everything that's going on, children are learning a lot of stuff they shouldn't be learning.
Yes.
And with paranormal investigating, I mean, I don't think, in my opinion, that there can be as much damage done by doing a paranormal investigation as the damage that they can get on social media or the damage that they can get in so many different areas that really, I mean, look at what people are doing with Gorilla Glue. They're gluing their hair, and that's coming from social media. That is far worse, in my opinion, than a child coming to Old South Pittsburgh Hospital and spending some time with their mom and dad in the dark communicating with Dr. Taylor. And yes, that's just my philosophy. I don't know. It's probably crazy, but that's kind of how I believe it.
Well, I'm not going to call you crazy. Excuse me.
And the other thing, too, is we have a lot of our volunteers, too, who, you know, I've got 40 volunteers, and many of our volunteers have children. And we do family nights, like we're doing one next month, where everybody brings their children and we have Nerf wars in the building. We play hide and go seek. We do stuff with, and like I said, these are people who are on my team who, you know, they don't feel threatened or they don't feel like their children are in danger in the building. Otherwise, they wouldn't bring them either. Has a lot of the kids that are on our team, have they had experience? Oh, absolutely. I mean, Leanne's sons have heard voices, have seen shadow figures. And I think what's really unique about it is that Leanne's children aren't afraid of it. They're not afraid to be in the hospital. As a matter of fact, one of her sons, it was really funny. It's the middle of the night and we're doing an investigation and he's got to go to the washroom and boom, he just runs down the hall and the pitch black all by himself. And I'm, you know, we're running after him because we don't let them do that. But it just goes to show that if you're brought up in that environment and you don't fear it, you don't have that fear of a spirit or a ghost. And he didn't. He just goes booking down the hallways. Mommy, I got to go potty. And, you know, Leanne and I and Heath are running after him, catching him. No, you don't, you know, you don't go anywhere alone. But it just goes to show that when they're in that environment, they're not afraid of it.
Well, I think that's...
Leanne laughing on chat because I know she probably didn't want to share.
She said that her kids love Old South Pittsburgh. So, and yeah, Denise is saying that Yeah, her kids learned in their haunted house back in the 90s. So the child's maturity actually is the key ingredient. And I would agree with that.
And I agree with that.
Because, like, I'm not going to want to take a child to the Bel Air house. I really wouldn't take one to Hillsdale. But, yeah, right. You were there.
Yeah.
But,
right.
Yeah.
And you're right. There are locations that we know that might be more
malevolent
than other locations.
Yeah.
And so as a parent, that's where we step in and we say, okay, we'll take you to OSPH, but we're not going to take you to the Bel Air house, or we're not going to take you, because as adults and as paranormal investigator, we know that there are areas or there's hospital or there's locations where we might have a spirit in the building. That's just, you know, the old verbiage goes that when you're alive and you're a jerk, you're not going to change when you're dead. So why take your child to a location where we know that there's a spirit in there that just may not be as friendly as Cat is?
There you go. I am generally a safe environment.
Yeah, you
until
are.
Until I'm not.
Very
so.
Soothing.
Thank you. Put you to sleep.
You're welcome.
That was funny. But, you know, it's just a really interesting concept because there's so many different opinions on that topic. I have been with a group who the founder brought her children to investigations, and even investigations on sites that, you know, we weren't very well versed with. And I wasn't comfortable with that because she was pretty young and she was very much, you know, oh, well, the ghosts need to talk to me kind of a thing. And I was like, well, that there's nothing wrong with that if they talk to you. Yeah, I didn't say that, but I was just kind of like, yeah, but we're in someone's home. And this isn't, you know, I didn't know how to deal with that because she wanted to be the one communicating with spirit. And it was just kind of like, I don't know if that's always safe, especially with one that young, if there is negative activity happening in the home. So I'm torn. I think that it does depend on a child's maturity. But it also depends on the activity that's happening, especially in a residential case, because you never know what you're going to come across. At least with a public venue, you have an idea of what to anticipate. So it's just one of those things. It is definitely a personal preference. But if a child is interested, has skill sets, and wants to learn, that's fine. But all those people that would go to, like you're talking about cemeteries, you know, down here we do, you know, Decoration Day in old time cemeteries. And those are going to be familial spirits all over the place because you have whole families that have their own cemetery and stuff. So it's like you said, you're going to be exposed to them anywhere, and to be comfortable should something happen is important. So I think it just depends on how you teach them.
Even if you take your daughter, you know, if you have a grandfather or great grandfather or great grandmother who's living in a senior facility, you know, an assisted living, I mean, there's people who die daily there. I mean, there's a lot of death in those buildings.
A lot.
You know, so once again, I mean, death is all around us and spirits are all around us. And I agree with you. A lot of it does have to do with the maturity of the child. And it also has to do with the parents. I mean, it has to do with what the parents feel is comfortable and what their opinion is. And, you know, I would never walk up to anybody and say, you know, your daughter should get involved in this. Because that's, you know, they're not my children. You know, this is just my opinion. This
is
what works for myself
thing. And
my children. And it certainly is. I mean, you know, like you said, at the end of the day, now, you know, touching on the residential cases, now that to me, I would never bring my daughter to a residential case, because generally residential cases, you're asking for help. You've got something in your house generally that's unidentified, that you don't know, you know what I'm saying? That's a completely different situation. And generally people who have spirits in their house don't reach out for help when there's not an issue going on.
Yes.
So to bring a child into a residential case where you possibly have something that is beyond the scope of what we're normally used to, I think now that I would draw the line at. I would not allow my children to do something like that, because, like you said, you don't know what you're walking into. And if that resident of that residency doesn't feel comfortable in their own house, I'm not bringing my 12-year-old daughter to something like that.
Right. And, you know, it just was, that was something that concerned me, because I've been on residential cases where I was uncomfortable, you know, that I didn't feel, well, that I felt vulnerable in. You know, I wasn't scared, but I was aware that there was something there that was completely capable of wreaking havoc. So you just have to watch that. Can you believe that our time is up?
Oh my gosh. Kat, every time, we got these 3 and 4 hour shows.
Well, I'll tell you, I think we definitely have 3 hour shows on us.
we might lose most of our fan base, because I think they probably get tired of listening to us after a while. But hey, as long as you and I are having fun, who cares, right?
There you go. I like how you think. So tell people events that you have coming up if you want to share those.
Oh, absolutely. So we have a couple times a year we do a hide and go seek in the building, which is really kind of cool. So our next event is actually March 12th. It's a Friday night. It starts, I believe, at 5 p.m. We play hide and go seek in the building. Everybody's invited. We give out prizes. I'm not going to tell you what, because some of them are pretty cool. After the hide and go seek is over, we break for dinner, and then we go into a paranormal investigation. The hide and go seek is really cool because our spirits have a tendency to get involved in the event as well. And wouldn't surprise me at all if we had a couple people touched or told I found you. So those are really cool. That's March 12th, and that's hide and go seek. Really cool. We're really excited. On April 10th, we have Mustafa, we have Brian, and we have Rochelle from the Ghost Hunters. They'll be out to do a celebrity paranormal investigation, and that's on April 10th. That's a Saturday. And then, Kat, you're going to be one of the first ones that we're going to announce this on. The Ghost Brothers are going to be the house, and they are going to be in the house. Oh, I'm going to get the date wrong, but I believe it's August, so it's going to be a little bit warm out there, but they're coming back.
Is it the 7th and 8th?
And we want to make sure that COVID is completely gone, because is it the 7th and 8th? It is August 6th and 7th. Oh, you were
6th
so
and
close.
7th. It's I was so 7th. Close to not have my calendar in front of
you
me.
You were so close. And one of the things we're doing with the Ghost Brothers is we are going to do a hide and go seek with them. And on that night, we're going to win some pretty cool gifts as well too. So that is August 6th and 7th. And we're really looking forward to them. We did an event with them in Rosemont back in January. And I will tell you, the energy that these boys have.
Yes.
Oh, they're a lot of fun.
They are a lot of fun.
With the Ghost Hunters on August 10th, Ghost Hunters on April 10th, they're going to be a lot of fun. Brian and I have been talking a lot, Mustafa and Rochelle, and they're excited to come out. So the April 10th event is going to happen pretty cool. And then we're working on a couple of other big events that are coming up. Not going to tell you yet, but one of them is going to be incredible. And that one we're shooting for September or October. But most importantly, we have something that's really cool. We actually have a merchandise page. It's osphmerch.com. And we sell tons of cool t-shirts. We have some limited edition Vans gym shoes coming out. They should
oh
be
my
available
gosh.
This summer. Oh, yes.
That is Vans so cool.
So if you want to get your OSPH Vans on, we'll have those. We've got t-shirts, yoga pants, all sorts of good stuff.
Yeah, yoga pants.
The lady who does it. Yeah, we got yoga pants too. We got men's sweatpants. The young lady who does it, her name is Brooke Travey. She owns BC Graphics. And I will tell you, she does some amazing work on t-shirts. So if anybody's looking for anybody out there to do some t-shirts, look her up on Facebook. She's BC Graphics. And like I said, she does all of JB's merchandise. She does all of our merchandise, reasonably priced. And her stuff is just phenomenal. Very,
terrific.
Very creative. Anybody who goes on the OSPH merch page, we'll see. Those are all her designs. She does some really good stuff. So that's
well,
pretty
Sherry,
exciting. We just launched that a couple of months ago.
Sherry said that you advertised all South Pittsburg hoodies, but she can't buy one on your website, and she needs it.
We have not. Okay. Hey, Sherry, get a hold of me personally, and I'll get you the prices, and I will send you a picture of what they look like. Because we're going into in the spring, we got our spring lineup, but we do have some of the hoodies left over. I think we got a couple of zip ups and a couple of pullovers left, and we have a new design on one of them that's really cool. It's kind of a teal blue color. But yeah, Sherry, just get a hold of me personally. You know how to get a hold of me. But yeah, the merchandise that we're coming up with is really cool, one of a kind stuff.
Yes, I can't wait. I'm going there now, but you know, as soon as we hang up. That because I love yoga pants. That's just part of the stuff that happened, that they're so comfy on my hip. It's just terrific. I'm excited about
yeah,
that.
Yeah, the thing is the stuff that we sell is it's good quality. It's not that
well,
real
of course
thin
it is.
Stuff. The yoga pants are actually pretty impressive. I actually got to help pick out the ones that we utilize and then help a little bit with the design, but it's primarily Brooke and BC Graphics who is doing all that.
Too
she
neat.
Runs with the ideas and does a really good job. So, yeah.
Too cool. Well, thank you so much for being here. I have had the best time with you. I always do. You know, it's nice when you get to sit down with a friend of some time and catch up because...
And you do know that our front door, Cat, is always open to you. If you want to come out and do an investigation, you're welcome anytime.
Thank you.
You know how to get a hold of me, but I'd appreciate you coming out and doing some investigating with me. And maybe if you're lucky, you'll get to see the Dr. Taylor phenomenon.
I would love to. I would love to. And I will. I will come up there. So, you know, I'm driving twice as far per trip now when I have to come down here. So I feel pretty confident that I will be fine doing that. So expect to see me tapping on the door.
I'll come and pick you up if I have to.
Thank you. Yeah. So, you know, for everyone listening, I hope you enjoyed this nearly as much as I did. I just love Ronnie. I love Old South Pittsburgh. And when you get conversation with Ronnie about Old South Pittsburgh, well, you are right in my wheelhouse. So... I just love it. We will be back on with our Texas hosts. They are fine. They are out of, you know, the woods. I hope they're not the ones with those, you know, $17,000 power bills. I haven't talked to them, you know, verbally yet. I do know that they are all planning shows for this week. So, but I would still continue keeping those people in your thoughts because... How do you pay a bill like that, right? And who is allowed to send you a bill like that in a crisis? So we'll just have to see what we can do for them. But thank you so much. Again, we will be here. And, you know, if you don't like the world you're seeing, you can change that because you can manifest that. You can smile. I know people say that the masks make them feel like people can't see their smiles. Well, your eyes smile too when it's genuine. So just let her rip, Tater Chip. Put that smile on your face. Just because we can't see those beautiful pearlies doesn't mean we can't see those beautiful eyes. And be kind. It's so important to be kind, especially in today's era. So... We will be back next week. Same cat channel, same cat time. Y'all have a great night. Bye-bye.
You are listening to WBHM Digital Broadcasting, Birmingham, Alabama.